Mainstream media exists for the purposes of indoctrination and manipulation of public perception. The world of free and independent media is growing, and with the upsurge in information now available in the public domain, it has never been easier to access free and independent media. The exploration of this information resulted in an experimental project which would provide a fully supported space for researchers, whistleblowers, and seekers of all kinds to express themselves and educate the world. On the 1st of January 2015, Conscious Consumer Network was launched to the world. Nobody thought we would make it this far, but CCN is the longest running free and independent media network of its kind. CCN is a unique collaboration of hearts and souls, bringing you information from different perspectives to educate and inform. Since we started CCN, we have had only one desire, the pursuit of a free, fair, just, sustainable world, and this has not changed. Having overcome many challenges over the last 2 years, CCN is here to stay, and we've got great things lined up for 2017.
It's all right to be just a little bit crazy.
Being creative is being a little bit crazy in just the right vibration. With that in mind, you should understand God's completely insane.
An educational comedy.
It's not a cause, not a movement.
It's not a social group you can slap a label onto.
It's an idea. It's an intention.
It's an intuition.
A mindset in which reality can be explored.
It's a genuine expression.
Discernment.
Critical thinking and imagination.
To look inward upon ourselves.
To better understand the external world around us.
And yes,
human egos are bound to be bruised.
With our silly, strange, politically incorrect,
your common building style of going about things.
Real and raw honesty.
Which invites you to be
to the fullest.
The driving force of appreciation is humor. So that's all this show is going to be, with the exception of the occasional tiny little bit of seriousness interjected. But yeah, mostly just humor. So if you have no sense of humor, prepare to embrace the butthurt side of the force. So on that note, here's a little disclaimer for all of the special SJW snowflakes out there that need it.
We wake up at the sunrise and you're staring back at me. I'm alone to the moment as we cast it out to sea. And the lights come on, the lights come on, reflecting off your skin. So burning stars are all we are, ignited from within.
It's your heart and soul, it's your flesh and bones. Don't you let it go. You're the star I find, bursting through my sky, taking no control. It's your
There is nothing more to life than life itself. That's the way I see it now. I see that life is just life. It's just to be. It's just to experience. It's just to laugh and engage each other in wondrous moments of joy and appreciation. There is nothing more. The accumulation of wealth is the illusion. The accumulation of stuff is the distraction. That's the way I see it. It's just a ridiculous side of who we are that keeps us so limited in that physical experience. I couldn't take the redundancy in life any longer. I couldn't take trying to be me, trying to be authentic in a state of consciousness that is in such a state of disarray. That's the way I'll say it, that the integrity of who we are as souls is so lost in our desire to be accepted as human beings that we cannot see through it, and we lose ourselves in it, and we get lost in it. And I felt it constantly tugging on me. I felt it constantly pulling on me. People begging me, asking me to be something other than what I was, and I couldn't give in, and I fought it the whole way. I had to be who I knew myself to be, even if it didn't seem to fit in what everybody else said I should be as far as the human being that I should be. I must say that it's difficult for us, those that know who we are, to exist in a society that is crawling with people who are so inconsistent with their own authentic nature. I would say that there are so many people lost in the greed, lost illiteracy of the human interpretation of what it means to be alive. I would say that so many of the human beings walking around the earth now are barely alive. That's the way I would say it. I see them as walking zombies. That's how I see you all now. I see you all as lost in logic, which keeps you so far from your heart, from compassion and gratitude and appreciation for life. It's as if you're walking through this human experience without any of the humanness. Why would we limit ourselves in such restrictive ways? I don't understand it. I never understood it, and I never could, and I never wanted to. I didn't really want to know why you all gave over to this ridiculous, surreal interpretation of what we are capable of being. It just seemed so limited to me, so what else was I to do but make fun of it? But to laugh at it and realize that it's all you could do with your fears and your uncertainties. How could you possibly find a more magnificent way of experiencing life? So what am I to say here today? What am I to say to inspire you all to live more fully? How can I be one to inspire? I would say that I want to. I want to be inspirational. I want to say, give it the good fight. I want to say, give it your all. But I can't. I cannot say that this life created in the way it is now, the way people, human beings are existing, is worth the good fight. It's not. Give up on the way people are living. Give up on that societal and the structure and the limitations that it brings to our innate, expansive nature. I say, walk away from it, turn away from it. In every aspect of your experience, detach from what is, from what everybody else is giving their energy over to. For it's all just keeping you down. Don't try to fit in. Don't try to be a part of this society that treats each other as insignificant. Don't you see the ridiculousness of this? We're supposed to be working towards a common goal, and yet we're telling individuals to fight for their individuality, to fight to be above another or better than another. How does humanity not see how ridiculous that is? How can we continue in this direction? I would say that what I'm experiencing is a wave of compassion that is blowing me over. I feel it. I feel it to the point where it lifted me beyond my negativity. That's what I would say. And that's a place that not many people thought I'd ever get. I didn't want to be negative. I tried hard to oppose that. But my negativity came from my understanding that this isn't the way we were meant to be. That this isn't how we were meant to treat each other. That there had to be more love, there had to be more joy, there had to be more laughter. And when you know something so certainly, in your heart of hearts, when you know it in the deepest core of your beingness, and everybody outside of you is telling you to get serious, to get straight, to straighten up and align with what is already existing in the physical. Well, what are you to do? Huh? What are you to do with your true nature, with who you really are? How do you keep that down? How do you hold that in? How do you allow anybody else in this human experience to dictate who you should be? I'm not just talking about me, I'm talking to each and every one of you. Don't do it. Don't give up who you truly are to appease some state of being that was defined by somebody else that doesn't know you at all. You can't continue to follow these restrictive ways of living because some intellectually inclined human egos think they know how people are supposed to be. Resentment. Toward humanity in the way that it is just giving in to this negative, self-destructive way of being. That's what I see. If you're willing to accept what is in this world right now, then you are creating more of the same. That's what I want to say. It's up to you. You're there. You're there right now. If you don't do the work, who's going to? We're here to bring joy. We're here to bring each other a sense of connectedness, oneness, and unity. And I can only do so much as a human being. I gave my effort everywhere that I could. I did what I could with what I had to work with, and that's what I want people to know. It's not so easy on the inside. What you see on the outside is never the full story, people. Never the full story. And I know that. I always knew that. I knew I had to do what I could do. It's something I knew. How do I know that? I don't know. You don't know. You know there are things you know about who you are and what you need to be or do that you don't know how or why. I could give you a million logical reasons why, but I'm not going to. I don't want to justify it or validate any intellectual interpretation of the inclination of my soul. This is what I felt I needed to do as the soul that I was, having the experience that I am, and of bringing your attention to the pain that's going on in this society because of the rigidity of the structure of this society. It's got to change. There needs to be flexibility. There needs to be freedom for people to be who they know they are here to be, not what everybody else thinks they should be, for whatever other reason. This isn't about that. So wake up, people. Don't miss another minute of this glorious experience, losing yourself in some egotistical interpretation of what you think would make you look good to others. Unfortunately, that human aspect of me continually questioned if it was enough. I thought I'd make a bigger wave. I thought I'd have a bigger impact in the direction this society took. I thought I really could change the world. I really thought I can help people find compassion in their hearts and a sense of connection between all human beings. I kept trying and trying to reach people in different ways, in whatever way that I could. And I guess what I wanted was the validation in some human way, or I could say, well, yeah, I did that. Look, that society changed because of me. I couldn't see it. Oh yes, now I see it. Now I see it in a big way. I did more than my share. I'll say that now. Isn't it sad that my humanness wouldn't allow me to recognize? And that humanness that I'm speaking of is the part of me that was inundated with this intellectual interpretation of what it meant to be successful, of what it meant to be appreciated, of what it meant to bring value. Oh, it's all there. It's so inconsistent what we interpret as true wealth. I knew I felt it every time I brought joy to somebody. Why couldn't that be enough for the human part of me? I felt it in my soul. I felt the oneness and the unity. It couldn't be enough because logic wouldn't let it. Because there's a pervasive intellectual energy in this society now that is trying desperately to remain in control, to remain the director of the human experience. But what I say is that's not going to be. That they might as well put down their weapons now, for they've already lost the battle. What I see now, which is an inclination in the human collective to be free from this oppressive way of existing that limits our ability to be free. Why is it not serious enough? Why is it not practical enough? Why can't we create a society that allows that to be more than enough? To be all that we need? Why do people have to feel that they have to put their gifts to the side and get serious first and maybe find some spare time to play with their gifts? Why does anyone think that's the way we intended to be here as human beings? I can only hope that what I see in the energy is true, what I see in the deeper parts of souls is that desire to change the way we live, to change what we allow to affect how we are, who we are. I can say that it is a wondrous journey, no matter what they say, desire to change the way we live. Freedom from being judged as not living the way I'm supposed to be living, as not being who I'm supposed to be being, not acting the way I'm supposed to be acting. The freedom that I am exactly who I am, who I meant to be. Compassion, gratitude for the joy I allowed so many to experience. For I see now how little joy there is in this life and how people actually feel that they're not entitled to it, that they're only entitled to tiny little doses of it every once in a while. Well, I'll tell you something. It's necessary for your livelihood. It's necessary for your health and well-being. We need to laugh often. Daily, if not in every moment. Well, I guess I would say there are two things you can learn from my life. One is how important it is to laugh, how important it is to be true to the side of you inside that knows that laughter is what life is all about. And the other is the obvious one, isn't it? It's what all you intellectuals are saying, that you just can't judge a person from what you see on the outside. And it's easy to create a facade in this environment that people will buy into because they want to buy into it. Because it fits. Because it looks accommodating. So my inspirational message here today is laugh. Let yourself laugh. Remind yourself of how important it is to find joy in this. Remind yourself that there's nothing more important. Nothing more important than letting yourself be who you know you are, regardless of what others tell you you should be. It seems like the theme of the moment in the human experience right now.
For the last year, Lockheed Martin Skunk Works has been working closely with the Russians to develop the most sophisticated, advanced, efficient, and state-of-the-art anti-terrorism drone weapon ever conceived of in order to put an end to the ISIS threat. We are pleased to announce that very soon we are about to deploy the Jihadist Undermining Destroyer Infiltrating Sentinel Goat Drone, or Judas Goat for short, with a futuristic AI operating system and an authentic external appearance. The Judas Goat is literally indistinguishable from an actual live goat. Powered by the newest quantum Tesla technology, when an ISIS member inserts their slick willy into the back-end interface port of the apparatus, the Judas Goat delivers a lethal 100 amperes of electrical charge directly into the central nervous system of the offending terrorist, resulting in zero collateral damage.
Holy Allah Akbar! Oh, such a hard, exhausting day, killing little babies and beating women. I need to wind down and relax and get my dick wet. There's a nice one over there, yes. Come here, baby. I got something for you. I'm gonna stick my Scud missile into your little Paris opening there, yes. Here comes daddy.
The Judas Goat will then automatically protect its cover and run directly into the nearest herd of goats. With its fiber optic adaptive fur, its chameleon capabilities allow it to change its color hue to match with the surrounding goats. Lockheed Martin strives for excellence in its continued efforts to combat global terrorism. As Vladimir Putin once said, "It's God's job to forgive the terrorists, but it's our job to send them to him."
Students at Pittsburgh University were so triggered by Milo Yiannopoulos' critique of feminism and Black Lives Matter, they demanded counselors should have been present in the next room to help people who were traumatized by his opinions. Listen to the absurd statements these whinging crybabies made after the event.
"So many of us shared in our pain. I felt I was in danger, and I felt so many people in that room were in danger. This is more than hurt feelings. This is about real violence. That so many people walked out of that event feeling in literal physical danger is not all right."
Real violence? What fucking violence? There was no violence. Words can't sprout fists and punch you in the face. Opinions can't physically manifest into baseball bats. Words aren't weapons. They can't cause physical pain.
Bing, 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 bong, bong, bing, 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 bong.
I'm triggered.
You're the only ones engaging in violence when you physically try to stop people from attending a Ben Shapiro lecture. You're the only ones engaging in violent rhetoric when you threaten to bomb Protein World and Gamergate meetups. You whine all day about other people's opinions being violent while using violent intimidation to stop those opinions from being heard. So boo-hoo, somebody disagreed with your stupid fucking opinions. Big deal.
Somebody call the ambulance.
What did you say?
There's this thing called free speech. Don't know if you've heard of it. It's so broad, it even gives idiots like you a platform to spew bullshit. Oh, but Milo dared to point out that college rape culture was a myth based on fraudulent statistics. The only rape culture in the West is when facts rape social justice warriors.
He didn't just say what I think he did he?
Universities are supposed to be about free-flowing debate, raucous dissent, and having your ideas challenged. Not trigger warnings, safe spaces, and censorship of anyone who you disagree with. If your reaction to your beliefs being put to the test is to start crying and demanding counseling, chances are those beliefs aren't very solid. Oh yeah, and being offended isn't a form of activism. Smearing yourselves with fake blood while chanting moronic mantras isn't going to boost your credibility. Listen up, pussies. Your feelings don't have rights. You don't have a right not to be offended. Facts don't care if you flee to your safe space and your crybaby counseling because you can't handle them. Facts don't care about your feelings. Fuck your feelings.
Social justice warriors are stupid.
Even a fourth grader knows that much.
Social justice warriors are stupid.
Say it again. You can say it, it's simple. Social justice warriors are stupid!
They're a bunch of dummies.
Social justice warriors are stupid.
You see it a little more happy?
Say,
like, social justice warriors are stupid!
Hey, I want my maple!
No, just social justice warriors are stupid!
I identify with nipple clamps. Feeling triggered yet?
Perfect, thank you.
If you really want enlightenment, then just lighten up.
You have quite a few interesting concepts that I would like you to tell me about.
Well, where do we begin?
Sigmund Freud.
You're a Colonel Sanders, dude.
Colonel Sanders. Or who he's trying to be. There you go.
Here is Sigmund Freud.
Who do you think this guy is?
Sigmund Freud.
There you go. What do you think of Sigmund Freud?
I think he was the father of psychology.
All right.
Any personal opinions?
It helped me greatly when I was growing up. Because I used to read Psychology Today.
What do you think of Sigmund Freud?
God, now you're making this tough on me. I'm a smart man. How's that?
Yeah.
Any other personal opinions?
I don't know if I believe everything he says.
So, Justin Bieber, what do you think about me, Freud?
What do you think of Sigmund Freud?
I think he's, like, super smart and stuff.
And stuff?
Yeah.
Would you like to expand on stuff?
No.
Okay. Thank you for your time. Okay, what do you think of Sigmund Freud? Okay, what do you think of Sigmund Freud?
He's a pervert.
Would you like to expand on that?
He talks about some very perverted things that happened during the childhood years.
Yeah. Do you believe in his concept?
Some things, yeah.
What do you think of Freud and his concept?
I think he's a little bit...
Are there any certain ones that you believe or disbelieve or anything?
Gosh, it's been a long time since I learned about Freud. The whole mouth thing, I kind of believe. That's with a cigar.
Have your cigar with you.
There you go.
Alright. What do you think about Freud and his concepts?
Freud and his concepts. I would say...
A bit out there. Odd. Yeah. Are there any certain things you believe or don't believe or
Freudian slips?
Yeah. Is there anything else you want to add?
Believe or disbelieve?
Theory is that you say things because internally you're thinking about them even though you're not thinking about them. Is that kind of his theory?
Yeah, like a double thinking thing.
The unconscious mind is...
Why should Sigmund Freud be remembered? Because he's the founder of modern psychology and he's helped many people by instead of killing them, he's talked to them. And by the way, he studied his dreams at night. Did you do that?
Well, if you want to talk concept-wise, one of my favorite concepts would be something I did very early in life. I did a lot of experimentation on. It's a little-known substance known as the cocaine, as the Colombians call it. And it's quite special, indeed. It is the bomb, y'all. A very strange reaction for us to unwind. The more I see, the more I do. Something of a phenomenon tells your body to come along. Save for later. And you see how the white person takes cocaine. They cut it up into little lines. And then they press on one nostril. While sniffing on the other. And maybe the other. And I'll save the rest. It's quite a strange, nice theme if you want to think about it. Yeah.
Was that for real?
Children, my name is Sigmund Freud and I'm going to teach you about some psychological concepts today. Our first psychological concept is the unconscious mind. Now that's where all your sick, perverted, dirty thoughts, you boys, that's where it lies. But also is where your dreams come from. Not to mention, you might think you only are thinking about one thing. You're thinking about at least like 18 things, you guys. That's how the psychological mind works when it's unconscious compared to the conscious mind. One of the concepts I developed under the influence of cocaine. Yes, is the psychosexual development concept. Jalen, on your knees. It's always so good. Anyways, and Hannah, you too. They're such willing participants. So Jalen is the daughter in this scenario. Hannah, you will be the father and I shall be the mother, okay? So Jalen. I don't know how to call a girl name. He's just so good. Don't you love mommy? Yes, you do. You're mommy's favorite little daughter. And you see, that is the Electra concept, where the daughter secretly thinks about killing the mother and sleeping with the father. It's some crazy stuff, man. Crazy stuff. In reverse opposite to that, to the contrary, we have the adjective complex. Now, Sam and Amber. Amber, come on, Amber. Yes, you do. Oh, they're so excited to be up here. Amber, you shall be the little boy, okay? Sam, you'll be the dad. And I'll be the mother again. Oh, goodness, it's the greatest. Well, let's see. If your father is shorter than you, you might as well be on your knees. Okay, so I have pretty much an example of what this would be. That's demonstration.
I hate you, Daddy. Mommy, I love you.
Yes, your mommy's favorite little boy. And that would be the Oedipus complex. Now, you see, I have learned that sexual development is not during the puberty days, but it actually starts during the child years. Now, I've been told it's controversial, and it doesn't make sense, and you're a horrible coke addict, Sigmund Freud, but you know, I mean, those people are just jealous because I do it like a boss. Is there any driver talking? So, the next thing, children, is what we call a phallic symbol.
Symbol of phallic.
And if it's plural, it's symbols. So that would be something like a banana, okay? So next time you want to eat a banana, just think, you're eating a phallic symbol. This is a very anorexic banana. So you see, phallic symbols are anything that look like either female or male genitalia. And you see, it's especially used subliminally in advertisements. So pretty much anytime you see anything sexual, that is a fallacy. Also, easy food to eat like popsicles and hot dogs and obviously bananas and anything that looks like male genitalia. I'm not sure the food that looks like female genitalia. Those are fallacies. The next concept we have is Freudian slip-ups. Yeah. Okay, Sam, would you like to come up here? Yes, you would, Sam. Have to. Come on. Oh, that's so weird. So a Freudian slip-up would be like something where Sam is holding a stack of these papers that obviously do not want to be picked up. And when I look at Sam, I notice my eye direction because I am consciously dreaming about Sam's boobs, I guess. That's how. And when I talk to Sam and I say, hey, that's a nice big rat. Instead of that's a nice big stack, that is because the unconscious mind is projecting through my verbal communication of what I want. So another thing would be if I was a male listening to the other male and Jalen is holding the rock and
God.
I'm looking down there. Weird. And I say, that's a nice cocky gather, I mean rock. That is another Freudian slip up. Another example is penis envy. Hannah, would you like to come up here? Oh yes, you would love to come up here for the demonstration. See, the penis envy is when the female wishes she had a penis because she thinks life would be easier with a penis. You're wrong. It's harder. Women are evil.
They rule the world.
So that is pretty much penis envy in a nutshell. Like, if Hannah likes Sam, not gay. She wishes she was a man. Another concept we have is talk therapy. So, Amber?
Oh, Amber, yes.
Oh, I find you always. So Amber here, okay. Amber here is psychotic, okay? We perform lobotomies and shock therapy to Amber. Amber's still crazy. So I decided to talk to Amber like a normal person to hopefully make her problems go away. And when that doesn't work, we feed her loving, tender medication, children. It always solves everything. Yes, go back to your cell, Amber. And you see, those are just a few concepts we have. But my favorite concept is cocaine. It's the bomb, y'all. What? You try and make everything I did on cocaine. You can't, because cocaine is new. Anyways, so that is all the concepts we have as we are being waved up. Thank you, Ms. Helsing. Thank you, unwilling participating.
I'll be the same, Herr Freud.
Another amazing discovery I found was when I was working and doing therapy treatments with people who've had psychological problems with them, and a friend of mine suggested the idea that he's been using for a while, which was to sit down and actually talk with the patient. And through all that talking, I've discovered that just possibly even just talking to the patient and loving tender medication can solve all of the mental problems. And, you know, I mean, seriously, like a pill a day and super expensive therapy treatments make all problems go away. Not to mention the greatest scam ever. Seriously. Rebellious teenagers forming opinions, next thing you know, white suburban crazy mothers sending their children to therapy, it's the greatest thing. And you can charge hundreds of dollars for hours. I mean, how do you think I pay for the iPhone? It's called seriously. Greatest ideas. Us Jews know how to do it right.
And remember kids, stay off crack. Do cocaine. It's a cleaner cut. And all the cool kids are doing it. And you want to be cool, right? Sure you do.
Okay, so listen to this, because I think you guys are going to think this is badass, right? A couple days ago, I shot a video of those of you who have seen it. You know, great. If you haven't, you probably want to watch it. It's basically where I said Amir is sick and tired of the bullshit. I put it on Facebook and tagged a bunch of people. And I just want to share my analytics with you because I've been inspired. Post has been inspired by somebody here, you know, somebody named Nabil. But he's one of the inspirations to why Amir decided to make the video. And before I show you the analytics, I want you to realize how powerful this is. I have been shooting videos for I don't know how long, right? And I guess it was like the same boring, stupid shit, so people weren't watching them. But I shot the video where I was just sick and tired of bullshit, and it was just, I was just so angry, I just couldn't even like write or do nothing. I just needed to just grab the camera and be like, listen, and just I just went at it. But that's basically what happened. So here, I'm going to share my results with you right now to just show you what just happened to YouTube. It just went, absolutely psycho, right? Look at what just happened. It just went from nothing, 3 minutes, 9 minutes, 0 minutes, 10 minutes, 2 minutes, to whoosh, 17 hours and 2 minutes.
Just from being crazy on the camera?
Just from being crazy on the camera. People just wanted to watch this.
You know what's really funny is my friend Dave Kelso. I know he's watching the Hangout right now because he's talking to me on Facebook, but that's exactly what he's sharing with me, is that, like, that's why he's so irreverent. Like, he has a YouTube channel called Paradigm Shift and Educational Comedy. I mean, if you haven't seen it, go check it out because it's pretty funny. But, like, his his channel is just so irreverent, and he is swearing, and he's even like the funny thing is he's just not afraid to be so crazy and irreverent, even in a circle of people who are super spiritual. I mean, so he faces a whole bunch of flack and shit from people, but, you know, it's because he has this crazy, irreverent humor, and just, he's like psycho on camera, but, I mean, he's so entertaining to watch and listen to, and that's why, and that's kind of clicking for me right now. Like, that's why people actually want to view things. It's because it's so ridiculous, right?
It is. We've got to do the crazy. I mean,
the title, the theme here, it's connection.
Welcome to Love Connection, where old-fashioned romance meets modern-day technology.
People just wanted to watch this. My next.
You know what's really funny is my friend Dave Kelso.
It's not enough. It's too vague to suffice what I'm looking for here. But what my dad told me is that it's connection. So here we have connection. What the hell? Here's something that I've been contemplating for a long time, and it's just kind of gnawing at the back of my brain.
So I turn to run, but it's not too long. There's a zombie chasing me, moving his hands like stumbling around like got my hands up, but not for too long. You know I'm trying to get away. Zombies and they're eating brains.
But like his channel is just so irreverent, and he is swearing, and he's even like
we've got to do the crazy. I mean,
as you've probably seen on one of my posts, where I'm awake but I'm tired and my inhibitions are gone, so here I am on a video. But I found the third ball. I've seen Austin Powers, I know it exists, and I found it, it's in there, and here I am.
Yeah, baby, yeah!
So, my question, one more thing. First world problems. I have my notes typed up on my iPad.
Editing is all Mac-based now. I mean, you know, there are programs out there on the PC, but whether you're using Avid or using Final Cut Pro, you're working on a Macintosh. Using a Mac is a little different than using a PC. It's not so much operating a computer as it is sort of tricking it, fooling it into doing what it is you really want it to do. You kind of have to sneak up on a Mac. I don't feel like I'm operating the Mac so much as I'm just there sharing the Mac experience. And if I can do something useful while the Mac is willing, so much the better.
Another app, but I can't multitask while doing a video.
One of the coolest features of the Macintosh is it's really easy to shut down. All you have to do is be using a piece of software and then poof, it goes away. It's gone. It's shut down. You didn't push any buttons. You didn't close. You didn't even save. It's just gone. Unless you want to shut down a Mac. Oh, that's a whole nother story. I mean, you try to close a program and it locks up, and then you do that funny, what is it, the cloverleaf period thing?
These unnatural and ultimately useless interrupt key.
Yep, so I have no notes. And my hard drive crashed.
Then nothing moves. Then you push the power button and it won't turn off. You go around and unplug it. And you better hope you're not on a laptop, because then you gotta find the damn battery and try to pull that out, or the thing will never shut down. So I put my CD in the CD-ROM tray, and I'm copying media off that CD, dragging it onto my desktop. I eject it, and where did my files go? It's the only operating system I know of where click and drag does not mean you actually copy or move anything. No, you're just making shortcuts on your desktop. So I've got my next CD, and I slam it into the CD-ROM tray, and lo and behold, it starts playing all by itself. I'm looking for a way to turn it off. Finally, out of desperation, I click and drag the CD into the garbage can. The system locks up. So I go to the cloverleaf period spacebar thing, hoping I can stop the program, and I get a little caution window saying, careful, interrupting this program may lock up the system. I try to click OK, but the system's already locked up!
What? I know everything about computers, and my hard drive just crashed. It's today. Woo!
I like the handle here. That's so you can attach a chain and use it as a boat anchor!
The Mac is practicing some kind of bizarre psychological warfare on me, because I'm working late at night, and at the corner of my eye I keep seeing this thing jumping up and down. The update manager is bouncing at the bottom of the screen like a Jack Russell fucking terrier! So I'm looking around in the list of the files, trying to find the executable it wants me to update, and if I click on any one of them by accident, I rename it! Oh no, it's been renamed nothing. It was some kind of important system file, and the computer crashes! On a PC, no data's really lost. I mean, there's a way to undelete a file. If you know what you're doing in DOS, you can go in and recover anything that's been corrupted. On a Mac, if you lose a file, you run to the store, you get a copy of the Mac version of Norton Utilities, you run back only to have Norton go, "You idiot! You own a Macintosh! The file is fucking gone!"
Gone, so I can't print them off either. So, I got, like, this little one sentence written down right here.
It's just gone! Don't have any tools or any kind of buttons or whatever dials or switches in the bottom of the screen, because if you reach for them, the dock menu comes up. You've got to, like, angle around and slide and dodge the thing to get to the control. It's kind of like boxing with your computer. I can put it on the bottom, I can put it on the left, I can put it on the right. No, I can't put it on the top. That's reserved for the mighty Blue Apple. Gah! My name is Hunter Kressel, I'm an editor, and I cut together everything you saw tonight on a Macintosh. Mac killed my inner child.
And it's just kind of a question, and I was hoping it just kind of let me kind of flow what I'm thinking of out there for what I want to do. But it's just kind of like when you go to the doctors, and you just hear, well, I'm going really off topic here, but anyway, where you just have to, like, keep telling your story to each doctor over and over and over again. So what happened? Well, I hit my head and blah, 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 blah. All right, next time. Well, so I hit my head, but, well, I kind of, and it just kind of...
Ain't nobody got time for that. 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 Ain't nobody got time for that.
It kind of turns gray and mushy, and it's out there. But it's just kind of, you don't have the details anymore, because you've, like... You've exhausted them away, so I've just kind of had this too much going on. And I finally got this video going, and well, the balls to get this video going. So I've like had practice rounds, I've written it all down, I've looked at it, thought about it, so it's kind of turned to the gray mush. But let's, okay, so the question is, why do we seek relationships? And that question is pretty vague. Let's try a different one. Why do we seek relationships with someone to call your significant other? Alright, now I have this question because... Wow, this is where you need notes. Because I do not remember. Give me a moment. It'll come to me. Just have your laughs and giggles and shit. Okay. I need more in a sentence. Great notes. Good job, Justin. Good job. Yep. Alright. So, let me just backtrack here. Wow, this is going to be like a really raw video. Especially since I can't edit it. So, alright. So, connection. Alright. What is it we are seeking when we find somebody and we call them your significant other? Why is it that suddenly you find this person and then all of a sudden instead of them being your friend or a colleague or an acquaintance, they have to be yours? And then with that, you're willing to take all this extra baggage for no apparent reason, and apparently it's more special when you put a name on it instead of when you just treat them as your friend or an acquaintance. Why the heck is this? And it's kind of just been back there, because for me, everything needs to have a rhyme, it has to have a reason, there has to be something going on with it. And it's just one of those things where it's just irrational and it's stupid. And it's just kind of there. And it's one of those things where somebody just beat me down and tell me how it is, or something, you know, because I really wish I had better notes. That's because. I need my notes.
And cut?
Yeah. I don't have scissors, I just have a shovel.
You can press stop.
Oh, okay. But it doesn't say stop, there's just this red button.
You can press the red button, Dave.
I can?
Yeah.
With that?
Yeah.
With this?
Hey! Red button.
Oh, I'm sore throat, coughing. Is anybody else out there maybe got Ebola?
I do.
Ebola!
This video is for all you stupid fucking trolls and haters online, saying mean and hurtful things about fedoras. Well, guess what? They rule harder than you, dipshits. You don't fucking know anything about this hat, idiots. Quite frankly, I just think you're jealous-ass haters, because you couldn't even pull off this look. You couldn't even wear a fedora if your life's depended on it, because you know what? It's class, and class is for men and swag is for boys. But you wouldn't know shit about that, fucking haters. This hat is for what cool people wear, and you can't figure it out. You sit there online on your fucking websites and you say bullshit about it, but guess what? It's just a hat, and you're not even cool enough to wear it. So next time you think before you do trolling. I'd implore you to do a little bit of thinking, if that's even possible for you, to think before you do fucking hating on fedoras. They're just a hat, and you're just a stupid swag idiot. You think swag is so cool, well guess what, it's for boys, and class is for men. This is class. That's all I got to say to you stupid-ass haters and bullshit bully trolls. You don't know shit, you don't know fashion, you don't know anything about this world if you keep saying bullshit jokes. I know you're just trying to be stupid and ass funny, but it's not fucking funny. Get the fuck offline if you're gonna keep saying this bullshit. Keep spouting it out of your stupid ass keyboards that probably aren't even mechanical. Listen, log off, idiots. You don't know shit. You stupid swag. You don't know shit, and I dare you to say one more fucking joke and I'll slit your throat and neck. Anyway, that's it, haters. See you later, fucking idiots.
Look, motherfucker, Fedora isn't a hat, okay? It's a distribution of Linux, alright? So, like, stop busting on Fedora Linux. Like, okay, I run Ubuntu because it's cooler, but, you know, Fedora's still cool, too. And you're busting on Fedora Linux because you're saying it's a hat, and you don't know shit about operating systems. You're either probably some pansy Mac fanboy, or you're running like Windows 8, which is like the worst fucking ever, or you're getting gang raped by the so-called free Windows 10 update, and they say it's free, and they say to update, but really when you update, it's like, ha, fuck you, it's only free for a year, now pay, motherfucker. So yeah, like you have like swag, like a fag, and I've got class, like an ass, okay? So, shut up, you. You're like, just, you need to get offline, because like, you're like picking on Fedora Linux, because you're a meanie poopy face hater who like sticks up his middle finger like every 5 seconds because you're such a hater. And I'm a Common Core student, okay? I learn more with Common Core, so don't you diss on globalist corporate controlled brainwashing systems, okay? They're your friend. They are. And if you say they aren't, then you're an anti-Semite and a racist, and you hate black people, and you fucking stick your dick in Confederate flags, okay? No, wait, what dick? Okay, so you stop bashing Fedora Linux, or I'm gonna slick the neck hole pussy fuck of your pinky finger, okay? Okay, so, like, and I can fucking wear black, too. You're fucking copying me, you poser. So, stop busting on Fedora Linux, cause, yeah, you poopy fuck.
I like singing.
I like dancing.
I like trains.
Hello, Mind Turtle.
Hello!
Ah, crap!
Welcome to Education.
Perfect, thank you.
If you really want enlightenment, then just lighten up.
Screw gravity.
Hello, Armageddon Turtle.
Hello! Suddenly, pineapples.